All right, so today we need to talk about planning and strategy. And I will admit that this is one of the more boring chapters to talk about because I don't have any videos for us to watch. This one is more quantitative, more just sort of plugging through the information. So I apologize in advance that it's not as friendly and fun and alert and chirpy as some of the others where we can watch interesting ads. So prior to the internet, your text tells you that media buying was fairly standardized. And then they tell you what the steps were in the standardization process. I would submit to you that I would agree with the fact that it was extremely standardized, but I don't think that people actually went through this. I think most, particularly, again, most businesses in the United States are small to mid-size. They're not General Motors. They're not Ford. But if you work for General Motors, these were the steps that were probably going through the buying decisions in terms of planning and strategy for integrating your media buys and planning your IMC plan. So you'd identify the target markets that you want to select, that you want to make your pitch to. Obviously, Ford has decided to do what? What does Ford do? If we're thinking about Ford today, what did I tell you Ford has decided to do that's a big step? They've obviously selected a whole lot of targets that they're getting rid of.
Yeah, they're getting rid of the cars.
They're getting rid of all of their cars except what?
The Mustang.
The Mustang. They're getting rid of every single, so they've obviously decided that they are going to target two basic groups. People who need trucks, or people who think they need trucks. I really question whether or not a lot of people need trucks that they have, and people who want sort of that all-American muscle car. The others, who was a big market that Ford used to sell things like the Ford Taurus to? They're also going to do the SUVs. And so what they're hoping in terms of that market that they're going to pick up is, rather than what markets used to use, for example, the Ford Taurus?
Old people,
okay. By the way, if you read a book years ago called The Millionaire Next Door, if you wanted to become a millionaire, there was a couple of guys that wrote a book called The Millionaire Next Door, and then they followed it up with a sequel called The Millionaire Mind. And the number one car at the time, I believe that they wrote the book in terms of what they drove, they thought they would, when they interviewed all these millionaires, that they'd walk into the hotel where they were having the interviews, and there would be all these Lamborghinis and Rolls Royces in the parking lot. And I think the number one car that they found was, at that time, it was like the Chevy Celebrity and the Ford Taurus were the biggest ones that were the cars that most millionaires drove. They were really, really boring. Millionaire next door was generally somebody that lived in a very middle-class neighborhood, had sort of a blue-collar job, was an entrepreneur or a business owner that just worked and saved money. It wasn't necessarily the finance guy on Wall Street who was driving the Rolls Royce or the Lamborghini. And so that was a big target for them. And the average millionaire at that time was over, I think, 55, so that's a good point. But there was also a huge segment of fleet vehicles that Ford targeted. The Taurus too. So lots of companies, particularly companies that had outside sales reps that provided cars to them, bought cars like the Ford Taurus. What are they betting on now? They're either going to get rid of that market, that target market, or they're going to bet on what? That those companies will switch over and buy instead of the Ford Taurus or, you know, one of the other cars that they make, that they'll buy what? They'll buy an SUV like the Ford Explorer, or what's the smaller Ford SUV?
The
Explorer is the midsize.
Yeah.
The Expedition is the full size. And so I guess it's the Edge, it's the midsize. So you just identify the targets, establish your objectives, do research, and then negotiate rates and placement. The internet has created a lot more opportunities, and it requires a lot more depth and breadth of knowledge in thinking about your integrated marketing communication plan. You have to really be a lot more familiar, and it's created a whole new lexicon and taxonomy that we have to get used to in terms of thinking about integrated marketing communication. It's provided lots and lots of new opportunities and ways that are very creative to engage the mind of the consumer, but it's also going to require that we be a lot more informed. And a lot of businesses, of course, are not. A lot of businesses just try things. A lot of small businesses particularly just start a Facebook page, and they just sort of put it out there, and I don't know that they think a whole lot about it, and maybe they should. So planning is the decisions or a series of decisions that are involved in delivering the message to the targeted segments. And it involves, obviously, establishing your media objectives. We talked a lot about that. So establishing the objectives, what's the difference between objectives and strategies? Well, the strategies is the plan of action to achieve the objectives. Deciding on medium. So medium is the general categories available to deliver your message, such as television, print, outdoor, radio. So TV and radio are broadcast. The vehicle is the specific carrier within a category. So for example, if you're going to do a TV ad, you're going to put it on. If you're looking at the vowels types, one of the things I used here was as an example, 60 minutes. So for 5 points, if you think about the vowels type, who can give me an argument? What kind of vowels type and product would you advertise on 60 minutes?
Analytical.
You think an analytical? Okay.
Well, I would normally say like
the analytical is a social style, so I'll agree with that. What's the vowel type that sort of corresponds with analytical? You can look it up.
Believers.
You think believers corresponds with analytical?
I think thinkers.
I think thinkers is more closely corresponded with.
Normally, if it's a television, I'd say believer or survivor, but 60 Minutes is not a show I would expect a survivor.
No. 60 Minutes is not a show that survivors are watching. Survivors are probably looking for what kind of show?
Rick and Morty.
What?
Rick and Morty.
Rick and who?
Rick and Morty.
I don't know what that show is.
It's good. That's fine. That's fine.
But
it's fine that I don't know if that
shows. But
if
you all be on that, then a survivor would be watching that, or would they be watching
like, they'd be watching something like really crappy.
What do survivors use television for?
An escape.
They use it for an escape. So what kinds of shows are they going to like?
Comedy.
Okay.
Or soap operas.
Soap operas. They can fantasize about their own lives, maybe, in projecting. A lot of the soap operas are going the way of the dodo, by the way. They're being replaced because soap operas are, I don't know if any of the major carriers, do any of the major carriers still have any of the major networks? Not carriers, major networks still produce soap operas? Some of the soap operas were moving on to things like they were producing them on Netflix because they had such a strong following, but a lot of the soap operas have actually have ended. When I was a kid growing up, there were all kinds of soap operas during the middle of the day. And why were they called soap operas?
They used to be when the soap commercials came on.
They would be when the soap commercials came on, and they were targeting who? Housewives, who were, you know, they'd sell laundry soap and Dawn dishwashing detergent and Palm Olive and things like that during those time frames. A lot of the soap operas are leaving the market. I think there may be one network that still carries a soap opera, and I think it's The Young and the Restless, but I'm not absolutely certain about that. But you're right, survivors are going to look for an escape.
They have them on Telemundo.
They have them on Telemundo.
Oh, yeah, they're intense.
Oh, yeah.
Those are telenovelas.
Telenovelas, those are intense. I watched a translated one of those.
They're big, yes.
And it's, oh my God.
I was going to say.
So, if you think about prime time, what kind of shows are survivors likely to watch? It's not going to be 60 Minutes, I'm going to agree with you. If I think about back on primetime, how about, what's the like, fantasy fiction, like Charmed. I don't think that's still
or
on.
Once Upon a Time.
Once Upon a Time. I would think that that would probably be a good one for survivors because it allows what?
Fantasy.
It allows fantasy. It allows escape. You don't have to think terribly hard about it. 60 minutes is something that the stuff that they cover is pretty in depth and you have to think about. So you said analytical and you said thinker. So what product would you then say? And be sure and remind me to give you your points. You have got to come up and give me, Scott. I will forget. What kind of product is the thing you're going to appreciate on 60 Minutes? What kind of products are advertised on 60 Minutes?
Something innovative.
New technologies.
Yeah.
Okay. New technologies.
I don't know.
You could even go beyond that. Yeah, the Herding Cats. What was a technology company?
BES, that was a technology.
So those kind of products, I mean, I would say just innovative products, new, but something that would become pleasing to someone that's intelligent. So I would just say to me,
okay. What about cars? Investments?
Investments. Oh, insurance.
I think you could definitely see the Schwab commercials being played on 60 Minutes. I think that would be a good fit. What about car commercials?
Oh, yeah.
More luxury.
Okay, luxury cars. All right.
But also insurance.
Insurance. But are you going to, you think that it's a good one for, say, Geico on 60 Minutes?
Maybe more life insurance,
isn't it? I don't know.
Geico does everything, but yeah. What most people start with and what most people start in buying insurance, their first experience in buying insurance for themselves is when they turn 16 and they get a car, right? That's your sort of segue into insurance. But I don't know if Geico advertises on 60 Minutes. I would be willing to bet that they do. But would State Farm be a better one to advertise on 60 Minutes?
I think if you're watching 60 Minutes, you're probably a lot more insurance than just your car.
Okay.
Probably you're older.
Right. Geico and Progressive are largely seen, I think, as being bought by younger people. Maybe who are more price sensitive than something like State Farm or Farmers, things like that. We were talking about media vehicle. The reach is the measure of different audience members exposed at least once to a media vehicle in a given period of time. And then coverage is the potential audience that may receive the message through the vehicle. So those are things that you have to think about. How much coverage are you getting and what reach are you going to get? And frequency is the number of times a receiver is exposed to a media vehicle in a specified period of time. So those are terms that we use when we think about planning and IMC. So the media plan. What is the goal of the media plan? Your text has a long sentence that I think can be boiled down to, you want to get the most effective reach with the largest number of your target customers at the lowest cost. So you want the most effective manner. Now again, when we think about this, you want the most effective manner to reach the largest number at the lowest cost. There is a difference, and you have to think about this. There is a difference between effective and efficient. What is probably the most efficient way to reach the largest number of people anymore out there? It's email, don't you think? For certain demographics. And that's effective, that's efficient. Is it really effective though anymore?
Yeah.
I mean, it's horribly efficient. So what you're looking for is effective at the lowest cost. So there's a combination. The lowest cost factor is sort of the efficiency consideration. You can have something that's enormously effective, but way too costly. What's the most effective IMC tool that you can use to get a customer? Well, if you can afford to have people actually go out and knock on doors, that may be the most effective. Because it's hard to tell somebody who's standing there no. In fact, in the day and age when the door-to-door salesman was prevalent, because people are overwhelmingly polite and don't like to say no, they would put up signs on their door so that they didn't have to say no, that said what?
No soliciting.
No soliciting. Media planning is difficult because we lack, in many instances, information. There's an insufficient amount of information. Why is there an insufficient amount of information? It may be either too costly or actually impossible to obtain a precise metric. This is the difference between survey data and census data. When will the next census be?
2020.
Right. And that's how far away?
2 years.
2 years. Is that really a census?
What does it get exactly everything? Some.
The definition of a census is what?
It's an official count of or survey of a population.
Of a population. An official count, survey of a population. And the idea is if you're using the population, so if we think about this in terms of statistics, right? One of the things that we look at with regard to populations are various measures of central tendency. Those are generally mean, median, mode, and some say range. And then we also look at measures of dispersion. And so one of the most popular measures of dispersion is what? Anybody remember from statistics?
Dispersion.
Like the measure of central tendency is median mode range and standard deviation.
The bell curve.
The standard deviation is defined as lowercase sigma, the square root, uppercase sigma, xi minus mu squared over again, right? You have a sample. This would be for a census. You almost never use this. You use a sample, which is S equals the square root of sigma xi minus x bar squared over n minus 1. You lose 1 degree of freedom for using a survey. The census is not actually a census. We call it a census. It's just a really big survey. And why is it a really big survey and not a census? And there's a point that I'm trying to make here. It's a really big survey because why?
People lie.
That's one.
Or they won't fill it out because they don't want to give away their.
It's really, in this day and age, with Donald Trump as president, and I'm not making a political statement here, I'm making a factual statement. There are more people that will avoid the census in 2020 than did in 2010. Just as a result of the fact that they are afraid that if they are an undocumented individual, that they may be deported because they don't want to have any contact with a government agency. So we will not be able to count everybody. So it's a really big survey. In theory, could we get everybody? So it's not just there's people that we're going to have a problem reaching because they distrust government. There's also people that move during the time that they collect the census data. There are homeless people who live under bridges, and they actually do try to do this. The census takers actually do, or in the past, I don't know if their budget has been cut, but they'll try to do this. But they actually used to do this. They used to actually go to homeless population centers and try and count people and get them to fill out census information, but it's really a big survey. And the reason I bring this up is because in thinking about if the federal government can't get everybody in the United States, if they can't get with the voluminous amount of resources that they have to conduct this research project, what are the chances that we're going to actually be able to get absolute everybody who watches a program to sit down and take a survey and tell us whether or not they had ad recall and whether or not they, you know, like the ad? We're just not going to have it, right? We could, in theory, do it. What would be a really easy thing to take a census of? What's a population? A population in statistics is defined as a well-defined collection of units. So what would be a well-defined collection of units? Well, everybody in the United States. You've got a geographic, you know, in 2020, you've got a geographic boundary and you have a temporal boundary, right? We're gonna do it from this time period to this time period in 2020. It's gonna be really hard to do. What could we actually accomplish a census of? Well, if we define the population as everyone enrolled in integrated marketing communication on October 11th, 2018 in CRN 15734 or whatever this is, we could probably accomplish that, couldn't we, in terms of a census? But we're not really going to be able to generalize much. That's not going to be a very useful definition of a population. And so we're not going to be able to generalize very much from that. And so we're going to have to rely on insufficient information with a lot of this. That doesn't mean that we shouldn't try, and that you should just throw darts at a dartboard and planning your media, but recognizing that it is costly to obtain that kind of information. There are timing issues. So when do they look at ratings? What are the sweeps periods according to your text? In television, they're done in February, May, July, and November. And then they use this data to then generalize to other months of the year. So they do these sweeps periods in these months, and then they generalize that out. So they're making assumptions about viewing habits in those other months where they're not gathering data. The other problem is that when a new show launches, did anybody think, for example, what's the most popular sitcom on television today? It's Big Bang Theory. They are the highest paid actors, and they're going off the air after this season because what?
Characters leaving.
Yeah. But did they think, for example, when they started the show, did they think that Jim Parsons' character, who's Sheldon Cooper, who my mother insists I'm Sheldon Cooper, I don't see the resemblance at all. I'm much funnier. Yes, and I'm not on the autism spectrum to the extent that he is, I don't think. I actually do exhibit empathy from time to time. But did they think when that show was developed that he was going to be the main character? I think I told you the answer to this.
Yeah, they got that idea.
Oh, they thought, who was the known quantity in that equation? Jimmy Galecki, because he'd been on one of the most popular sitcoms at the time, which was?
He was on Roseanne.
He played Darlene's boyfriend. And so there's no data. I mean, they didn't know that that show was going to reach the popularity, that it was going to run for the number of seasons that it did. Another problem in developing the plan is inconsistent terminologies depending on what media you're using. So in print, they talk about cost per thousand reached. In broadcast, it's cost per rating point. And in outdoor showing, so billboards and things like that, it's the number of showings. And how do you really get the number of showings? How do they get that? For example, on a billboard, what do? To estimate the number of showings.
People who drive by.
How do you do that? In the olden days, they actually had to put somebody out there and count.
That's something
that would be a terrible job.
Huh?
It'd be awful.
It'd be a terrible job. They actually put people out there, you know, before they had counters. Now they can do traffic counts. How can they do traffic counts?
Put the little things on the road.
They can put the things on the road. They can take video and look at it and analyze it, so they can actually do that. But if you're looking at these things, what's the wrong with, so if you think about the cost per thousand reached in print, suppose you're in the daily disappointment, also known as the daily Oklahoman, the daily liar. Let's suppose you have advertising there. So you're paying cost per thousand of their subscription, you know, their circulation. Well, where are you at? In theory, where would you want to be? That everybody's at least going to, in theory, see it, fix it up. Front page and above the fold. Do they have a lot of ads on the front page above the fold?
No.
So how many people actually, you know, if you're buried in the travel and leisure section, which I don't think they have anymore, what are the chances people are going to see it, right? You know, outdoor, they may be driving by, you may have a traffic count, but are they actually seeing it? The internet, of course, has created a whole new lexicon and a whole new need for a new taxonomy. So, inconsistency in terms. In 2006, a lot of the advertising groups, the ANA, the 4As, the DMA, the ARF, and the IAB, decided that they were going to try and come up with better metrics to measure this stuff. And as computing power has gotten better, we have the ability, in theory, to do this. One of the things that's happened in statistics, I was arguing with one of our stats professors in the College of Business, because she said, statistics hasn't changed in the last 50 years. Well, that's not true. In marketing, one of the things that I had to take a course in that I absolutely hated, that I thought was voodoo, was something called structural equational modeling. And believe me, I am not an expert in structural equational modeling. In order to do structural equational modeling, you have to have computing power that they didn't have at the birth of marketing. The old computers that they used when a lot of the founders of marketing science, and the biggest name probably as a founder of marketing science was my major professor's major professor. His name was Frank Bass, and he was at Purdue, and then he went to the University of Texas at Dallas, and Dallas started as a quant school in marketing. At the time Frank Bass came to prominence, I don't think, I may be wrong because I haven't really studied the history of structural equational modeling, but I don't think they could have done structural equational modeling. I don't know. I'm guessing that they couldn't, because they were using, actually, my major professor had to use punch cards. In other words, you put the data on these little cards and then you'd insert it into something that looks like a Scantron machine, and it would read it and it would take a lot and it would spit out a very tiny amount of data, and then you'd have to crunch it. And there just wasn't the computing power. Structural equation modeling relies on a series of, as I understand it, regressions to model. And linear regression is linear, but through a series of it, it tries to model, as I understand it, again, I'm not a structural equation modeler, nonlinear relationships. And so these terms that we had before the internet that we used to measure these metrics were very imprecise, and in theory, we can get better. And so the task force proposed using engagement as a measure. Of course, then there became a debate as to what constitutes engagement. What do you think constitutes engagement? How the hell do you measure engagement?
Well, I mean, for social media stuff, like clicking on a post that gets you engagement.
Okay. That's an example of engagement.
Yeah.
Can you have engagement with just a pure print ad?
I mean, it depends on, is it a print ad you have to pay for or not? Because you can show how you sold. I mean, that's about the best that you can really measure.
Well, I mean, again, we're not going to be able to get a perfect measure, because if you think about engagement, I think it's possible to have, in the olden days when people actually used to look through magazines, and there are people who still do this, that look through magazines when they go to the doctor's office. I see them. I live in Guthrie. There's a lot of Q-tips in Guthrie, you know, the frail elderly that are in the doctor's office when I'm there, and they're actually looking through magazines, or as I'm looking on my phone, they're looking through magazines. If you have an ad that they actually sit there and look at, and they take the time to read, and they will, it's kind of interesting to watch. Watch them. They are engaged with that. They're engaging their mind, right, with the app. But can you really measure that? That's like really in a hard, I mean, there's just flipping through, you know, and that's not much engagement. If you see it, I guess it's some. So how are you going to measure that? Good question.
No.
You're just stretching. Okay. All right. The Nielsen Company does studies that show correlation between programming involvement and ad recall. So the more interested you are in the program, I don't think that that's anything we should open the balloon over, the more likely you are to have ad recall. Another problem with developing a media plan is time pressure difficulties. Companies don't have forever and to analyze the data and crunch it and make decisions. There's something called time compression theory. And a lot of times when we, for example, when we develop a product, particularly for a small to mid-sized business, we have this product and or maybe we buy product and we need to get it out there and we need to get people to buy it because we've got to get an ROI, we've got to get a return on our investment very quickly. It's sort of like throwing a stone into the pond. What happens, or if you think about an earthquake, what happens when you throw a stone into the pond? Let's suppose it's a nice clear day,
the water ripples.
It creates ripples. Where the stone lands, what happens? Okay. So let's suppose. So let's suppose this is our pond, right? And we throw a pebble right smack dab in the middle of it. The waves around where that pebble are going to be what? Really tight. You're going to have really tight between the peaks and the troughs there. And as it goes out from that epicenter, what happens? They get further and further apart, right? The idea here is in time compression is that a lot of times we have to make less than ideal decisions because we're at that sort of critical point, the epicenter. And businesses don't a lot of times have the luxury of waiting to get all of the data. And then, of course, there's difficulties in measuring the effectiveness. So market analysis and targeting, of course, we've talked about this. Who are we going to target? Smaller and mid-sized businesses are going to use a lot of secondary sources. Larger businesses like Ford, of course, can afford to engage in primary research. The Experian National Consumer Study provides information on traditional media usage. And they also have a new media study, and they tell you about things. So they provide an index, and the index is the number of users in a demographic segment divided by the number of population in the segment and then multiplied by 100. If you have a number over 100, the use of the product is proportionately greater in that market segment than in a segment with a figure less, with a figure 100 or less. There may be a math question. I know math is scary. So, what factors do you need to consider in developing the media plan? Obviously, the first and most important to most businesses is going to be what? How much money do we have to spend? The size of the media budget. For most small businesses, that's going to be what? I'm going to tell you as a small business owner, that the amount of money we have to spend on media and advertising is very little. You know, I mean, I have a PhD in marketing. And if I had, you know, an unlimited, there's only so many rooms I can book. You know, we can only accommodate 40 people for a murder mystery on Friday and Saturday night. We generally do. We have 40 people every Friday and Saturday, but there's just a finite number. And that just generates a certain amount of revenue. And so I have to think about this. So even though I have a PhD in marketing, I could probably develop a radically new, innovative, and wonderful media campaign. The size of my business just dictates that that budget is not there. But the second factor does go in favor of people like me. and people like you, if you develop businesses, because the management capabilities that you will exhibit will probably be greater than people in the past. You all are what? As I'm looking around and you're playing on your computers and not watching me, doing something else. You're pretty technologically sophisticated, and so you have the ability to figure this stuff out. And the amount of information that's out there, so your management capabilities are, of course, going to be enormously important. And then the organization of any outside agencies that are employed are the internal factors. So who you're employing and who you get, that's something that you can control. You can obviously do what? If the agency that you have doesn't do a good job, you can do what? You can control that because you can do what to that agency?
Fire them.
You can fire them and hire somebody else. The external factors are economic factors. Even large businesses like Ford have to deal with economic conditions. So what's happening this year? It's not as big as in other years, but what's one of the things that will increase the cost of media coverage, particularly this month and next month? It happens every 2 years. Television and radio love election cycles because it means that what? There's more people that want to buy media, right? We've got, in Oklahoma, we've got a governor's race, and it's a tight governor's race. One of the things that they really love, broadcasters love about elections like this, is that it's a pretty close, so Drew Edmondson is spending a lot of money. He's behind the Republican, Kevin Stitt, but that means that for corporate advertisers, they're having to compete in those spots with those. And it increases, generally speaking, and in a presidential election year, the cost of media purchase increases exponentially. They take advantage of the fact that they know that there's going to be a lot more demand for their services. So the rising cost of media, and the examples of an election year, as inflation takes hold, that can cause rising media. Obviously, changes in technology. The internet has radically changed things and has really shifted the cost. In my business, one of the things is we've been able to actually reduce the size of our media budget because my mother is fairly technically sophisticated with social media, and we've been able to promote our business a lot through social media and internet advertising, as opposed to using what we used to do, which is we used the Gazette and newspapers in Wichita Falls, Wichita, Lawton, and places that were more boring than Oklahoma City. Competitive factors obviously also play a role. If one airline starts a huge advertising campaign, the others will feel pressure to do what? To match that campaign. To meet it. Where to promote, the geographic considerations. Obviously, you're going to waste coverage if you are trying to sell snowmobiles in Oklahoma. There may, in fact, be somebody who owns a snowmobile in Oklahoma. That person is not getting a lot of use out of it. The last few years, we haven't had enough snow to amount to very much. So where are you gonna sell? What markets are you gonna look at? The Survey of Buying Power Index is conducted for every major metropolitan area and provides information. And then the Brand Development Index factors the rate of product used by geography. So in an extreme example, you're going to have almost no rate of product used in terms of snowmobiles in Oklahoma. If you're selling business-to-business products, which includes governmental, in Oklahoma, what do we have less of than, say, a market like Colorado or New Mexico? I was horrified when I moved here in 1986.
Mountain snow.
So what do governments in New Mexico and Colorado buy a lot of?
Salt trucks.
They buy a lot of salt trucks and a lot of snow removal. The first year I was here, we got up and there was a light snow in Guthrie, and they canceled. I went to school and they canceled class because there was no snow removal in Guthrie at the time. They had none. Absolutely, positively zero. And when I said, "You have no snow removal," they said, "Oh, yes, we have snow removal." I said, "What's that?" God. God brought it, and God will take it. The good Lord brought it, and the good Lord will take it away. And so, you know, how much is used by geography? If you're thinking about just individuals, there's a hell of a lot more ice melt sold in places like Santa Fe, New Mexico, and Boulder, Colorado, and Telluride than there is in Oklahoma, although we do sell some. The category development index is the same as the BDI, except it uses product categories as opposed to brands in its numerator. And so in thinking about that, you need to establish media objectives, which is goals for your media program. Implementing your strategy. So once you develop the strategy, you develop your plan. It does no good to just let it sit, just put it in the desk drawer and actually let it sit there. One of the things that's been most frustrating for me, I'll never forget when I first started working at UCO 24 or 25 years ago, something like that, they decided that we were going to do a strategic plan. And I said, "Can we just put something down, or is this actually going to be taken seriously?" And everybody said I was a naysayer and had a bad attitude. And so we spent all this time developing. I was in the administration division at the time. We spent all of this time developing a plan that included, they wanted us to come up with three categories in our plan: high cost goals, mid-range goal, mid-cost goals, and low or no cost goals. And we turned in our plan, and the upper administration said, "That's a great plan. Tell us what goals you'd really like in the mid to no cost range." And so we identified the goals in the mid to no cost, and they came back and said, "Tell us what you'd like to do in the low to no cost range." And of course, I pointed out that there is nothing that government does that doesn't cost money. And so then the plan just got shelved and nothing ever happened with our strategic plan. And that can happen in business as well. Big businesses that are bureaucratic, just implementing can be a problem. So once you develop the strategy, you actually have to implement it. So considering the media mix, the text says, and this is one that I totally disagree with the authors about, that while only one media may be used, it's more likely that a number of alternatives are going to be used. I just totally disagree with that. I think most small businesses today probably use one or maybe two media. I can tell you that we use the internet. Now, we use different vehicles on the internet, but we use almost exclusively now internet advertising. And I think that's true. There are lots of people that are developing their small business. Mr. Young talked to me about his girlfriend who wants to start an internet-based business. There are lots of people that are doing this. They're selling almost exclusively through the internet. When I was in law school, there was a girl who paid for her entire law school. That was in the early days of eBay. And it was just so exciting because auctions create excitement. You can do this online. She paid for her entire law school. And at the time I went to law school was $900 credit an hour by buying and selling on eBay, all online. So there are lots of businesses out there that are going to use maybe only one media. Now, obviously, Ford is going to have to use television. They use radio. They use print because a lot of their buyers still, farmers still read farm journals and things like that. They're going to use internet because younger people connect with them that way. So the question is, what is the best media and vehicle to reach our target? And the goal is that you want to get the greatest coverage with the least amount of waste. And how do you do that? How do you get the greatest coverage. And again, this is not exact science. There are things in marketing that have become far more scientific than medicine. There are things that we can determine with a lot more precision than medicine. I've come to believe, after having 26 hours of statistics in my PhD program, that medicine is voodoo. Because if you look at their studies, and one of the things that I started doing since I'm interested in ethics is I've started looking at drug studies, drug trial studies, and they're not really scientific. And they really can't be. It would be unethical to do it. How would you really, if you wanted to do a really scientific study of a drug, you just randomly select people out of the population. Oh, Mr. DeGruy, we're going to give you this heart pill. I don't have heart disease. It doesn't matter. Take the pill. We can actually do that in marketing, though. We can actually get people, you know, we can just randomly select people in a population to target and get their information from them. So I've come to believe it is more scientific, but this part is not. So some of it, although we try and be as precise as we can and gather as much data as we can, so we're not just engaging in wild guesses, it's not the most scientific. So scheduling. Do you want to have a continuous pattern? This is usually used with things like food. They have continuous advertisements for things like, what are some of your favorite childhood foods? And if you think about it now, are kind of maybe not such a great one. Kraft macaroni and cheese. How many of you love Kraft macaroni and cheese? Don't slam Kraft macaroni and cheese.
I just like
all macaroni and cheese.
Yeah, macaroni and cheese. Like shells and cheese.
I used to love, my favorite as a kid, I now make my own mac and cheese because I've grown out. And so I make it with Asiago and Romano and Parmesan and sharp cheddar and cream cheese, a stick of butter, and 2 cups of heavy cream. You know, and so it's like, it is the most wonderful, delicious. And so I look back, my favorite mac and cheese when I was a kid, though, growing up, was the skinny mac and cheese, not the big one. They came with the sauce pack. I actually liked the stuff that was the powder, which is real, genuine imitation.
Oh, yeah,
cheese.
The orange dust.
Yeah, the orange dust. Yes. I love that. What?
Is it easy?
No, it's mashed. It's Kraft macaroni and cheese. It has the powder.
Really?
Yeah.
That's
never got mashed.
Yeah, what
kind of
I
use
Kraft,
so
I know exactly what it's talking about.
No, it's the powder, right?
But they do have,
which was the same idea.
They do have mine. It's like,
It comes in a pack.
Yeah.
When I was a kid, the bigger mac and cheese, which was the big noodles, it came in a can, in a little tin can. And you'd have to get a thing and a spatula and get it out of the can and then mix it in. And that's real, genuine imitation cheese product. It's a little bit more real, I guess, than the powder that's dehydrated cheese whey. I guess, sort of, with flavoring and oil. But if you think about that, you see the Kraft mac and cheese commercials all the time. They play them all year round. Their current one is, parents aren't perfect, but then they make us Kraft mac and cheese, and everything's better again. They show everybody being happy with mac and cheese. Because it is actually continuity, continuous pattern. You can have flighting scheduling, so less regular, where you advertise things during various seasons. So they advertise, in terms of cooking, sugar cookies and baking products a lot more this time of year than they do in the summer. Why is that?
Holidays.
The holidays, and a lot of people still bake for the holidays. You don't advertise snow skis in July 4th in Oklahoma City, because, you know, A, there's no mountains, B, there's no snow. And then pulsing is a combination where you have continuous, but you may increase it at certain times of the year. So Budweiser advertises pretty much throughout the year, but they advertise more heavily this time of year. Why? They advertise more heavily around July 4th because people are doing what?
Drinking.
Going to the lake.
Yeah.
And drinking. I had a friend who told me one time, she was a recovering alcoholic, that I said I was going to the lake. She's like, just remember, beer and water don't mix. And I'm like, oh, yeah, they do. You know, yeah, I don't know what lake you're going to, sister, but, you know, on my boat, that's got to have that. They advertise a lot more right now because of what?
Football
season. And everybody has football parties. What do you have to have at football parties?
Beer.
Blood light. Yes, and you have to have good old-fashioned all-American red-blooded Bud Light. Not that hippie crap that you people seem to like.
I can't.
I don't know, Stella Artois.
What?
That's just a horrible name. I can't even stand it.
It's
god awful.
Yeah,
it makes me.
Yeah, he doesn't like
microbrews. No, I don't.
Or IPAs.
Yeah.
Reptail Brewery is really good. It's a great one.
I just tried.
I just threw up a little bit.
It's called like.
I've tried it.
It's like hazy something.
Not good.
Yeah.
Hazy,
yeah, it's good.
That tire, all of those. Reach versus frequency. Reach, how much is necessary? Factors that you need to consider in reach is the product lifecycle. Is it a new product? Is it a product that involves high involvement? Frequency, the number of times you have to expose somebody in the media vehicle, and that's hard to gauge. The number of times you have to expose them. So how far do you have to go to get them? If you think about this, lots of people who listen to the radio also watch TV. So do you need to get both? Do you need to have coverage in both? Suppose you want to launch a new micro, God help you, brewery beer here in Oklahoma that has to be kept. The one thing that Coors used to do, they don't do this anymore. They used to insist, one of the reasons Coors had a much limited distributorship than Budweiser was they didn't, as I understand it, they did not pasteurize their beer, which meant that it had to be kept cold, which is probably why it tastes like skunkweed and commie crap, but, you know, as opposed to Bud Light, which is wonderful and delicious. You start your new microbrewery, Yow Yow, here in Oklahoma, and you don't pasteurize your beer, so you gotta have a limited distribution, sort of like Brahms. Brahms will only open up in places that they can get to because they're a vertically integrated company with regard to their dairy products. So do you need to get both radio and television in order to reach your target consumer? Well, maybe. Frequency is how many times you're gonna have to expose them to get them to react to your new microbrewery death implementing product. So establishing your reach and frequency objectives. Unduplicated reach, if the ad is placed on two shows that are at, for example, the same time, the number exposed only once is unduplicated. So if you're advertising, I don't know what's also on opposite on the other networks, Big Bang, but you can't watch both Big Bang and whatever it is that's on the other networks at the same time. Duplicated is the number of people exposed by two or more broadcast. So if you watch Big Bang and then Young Sheldon afterwards and they advertise the same products, the measure of the potential reach in the broadcast industry is the program rating. And they talk about gross rating points, which is the reach times the frequency. And the gross rating points The difference between this and the one below it is it uses a duplicate estimate to determine waste, as opposed to target rating points, which is the number of people in the primary target and the number of times, and it does not include a wasted coverage factor. So how long are you going to have to get, you know, based on estimates of the ratings, how many times are you going to have to expose people to it to get that, the reach that you want and the frequency desired? Determining the absolute effect of reach is probably unknowable. The number of times that you're going to have to get people to recall. The absolute, but they've settled on sort of a figure, which is three, which is called the three exposure hypothesis. Now that's just to get some recall, to get impact with regard to the effect of frequency. They say you have to have 10 exposures. In order to, 10 exposures will lead to recall and the development of attitude towards the brand. You have to remember to be flexible, because changes, obviously, in your plan may require modification. If you're not getting any indication of success, you might need to change your plan, modify it. And of course, budget constraints are always a consideration, and cost estimating can be difficult. A lot of bigger advertisers attempt to deal with the cost estimating by doing what? Having long-term contracts. We used to do that in my own business. We had a yearly contract where we agreed to advertise with the Gazette and the Wichita Eagle and the Tulsa World so many times, like four times per month, in exchange for reduced rates so that we could estimate our costs, so that we knew what our costs would be. And then, of course, evaluating. All plans require evaluation. Monitoring that to see that it's meeting your goals, and then tweaking it as you go along. Any questions about planning and strategy? Well, we're done 9 minutes early, so
you feel cheated. Pretty good the last couple days.
You let me know. We'll stay late on Thursday or Tuesday. I'm sorry, today's Thursday, isn't it? On Tuesday.
But is our next test after fall break? I think so. I'll have to look at it. I'm loaded up right now.
I think it's on my Thursday.
Thursday after.